The other day, my daughter brought home a kind of tear sheet or facsimile of a few pages in Scholastic News, a journal which I was hitherto unacquainted with. She's 8 years old, and I was shocked and somewhat outraged by what I read in it. It had been distributed in her class, innocently, I'm sure, by the teacher, but it seemed to me to represent the perfect text of what not to tell children about the world in which we live and how not to rear them generally in a time of, which is apocalyptic. It's a time of ultimate crisis. It's a time where dissimulation and isolation and escape from reality will ultimately end in disaster. Scholastic News had a picture on the cover of a young woman with her face painted with hearts, red hearts, and across the bottom it reads, "Should the US make more nukes?" N-U-K-E-S. And then it says underneath that, "This girl thinks the US should stop making nukes. She painted hearts on her face when she took part in the march against nukes. Nukes are nuclear bombs." It sounds as if nukes were rabbits or something before that's said. "They are the most powerful of all bombs. Our country has built many of them. So have the Soviet Union and other countries. Many people want the US and all other countries to stop making nuclear bombs. With so many bombs, people say they don't feel safe. Others don't agree. They want the US to keep building nukes. Find out why on page 2. And here is page 2 with the photograph of President Reagan and so on. And it says on page 2, some say more nukes. And underneath that, there is the text. Some people in our country do not agree with the girl on page 1. They think our country should keep making nuclear weapons. They say if we stop, the US could be in danger. That's because the Soviet Union and other countries make nukes. Right now, world leaders are meeting to talk about nuclear weapons. The leaders will try to decide how many weapons each country can make. They will also talk about ways to cut back on the number of nukes. And then it says underneath that, people from our government are at these meetings. They are discussing President Reagan's ideas. Later, the president and other leaders may get together to talk about nukes. Now, what is wrong with this text? And I think what is symbolically and deeply wrong with the text is roughly as follows. Time is limited. I'll try to make the points as briefly as I can. In the first instance, it is conceptually wrong in the sense that it takes for granted and tries to get children also to take for granted that deterrence strategy is necessarily a means of avoiding war. In the history of warfare among nation states, this has never been the case. Wherever there has been a great arms buildup, there has been a war, number one. Number two, ordinary deterrence strategy does no longer fit a world in which God knows how many nations, large and small, how many states, large and small, have access to, or in fact are themselves manufacturing, nuclear weapons. Let's say Pakistan. Let's say Israel. Someday Saudi Arabia. Maybe Argentina, and so forth and so on. Maybe Yemen. What holds them back? What kind of deterrent threat would hold them back under the condition which they believe that the death of people is superior, alternative to the survival of what they feel they represent? What's to hold them back from starting the cataclysm? So deterrent strategy is, first of all, conceptually wrong. With reference to the tone of the text, it is condescending. It also domesticates nukes. It comes up with a cute, an expression which is assimilated to a cute expression, the cute nuke. It does not let children in on the horror. And the horror is what we're heading for. Now, of course, the other side says, well, children could not sustain this. It would poison their lives. No. What poisons the lives of children is the lack of open, frank, and loving socialization, loving reciprocal relations with other people in their immediate environment. Children who have that kind of start in life, and as they grow, can reproduce it with other people, become children and adults who are not afraid to express their principles and who are not going to be shocked into numbness by the possibility of death. Children, it has been more or less established, can sustain anything if they feel that they have been loved, if they feel that there's a connection with another person. The child's sense of time isn't precisely like the adult's sense of time punching a time clock in a factory in Western civilization. The child's sense of time tends more toward the kind of eternal sense. The child incorporates the love into its being. Now, children who are reared that way are capable of making moral decisions. And it's that, the absence of such an effort in this little article on should we or should we not build nukes, as if these sides can be balanced on a seesaw. The absence of any kind of moral sense in this whatsoever, which symbolizes the absence of love and the falsity of socialization efforts in our society. And with the increasing role of the school and the diminishing role of the family, this becomes, with accelerated force, dangerous. It also isolates the child from reality in the sense that everything that happens is going on out there as on a television screen. They can make a choice as in a Pac-Man game, whatever they call these video games, with the consequences still being on the screen and not being something which is immediately pertinent, catastrophically pertinent to their own lives. Therefore, a kind of neutral, political, manipulative, tactical statement of the type that I read, whether for 3 or 4 or 5 year olds or whether for 90 year olds, is basically immoral, dangerous, and misleading. It is also, I think, symbolic of this evasion from an anthropological point of view. Those of us who are anthropologists and who have had the occasion to work in the field among so-called exotic peoples, who have been trained to understand the lives of peoples in many other cultures, will know that children are exposed to every reality that adults are. They see, they witness childbirth, life and death, they play their roles in all of these matters. And the result is an extremely rich human being capable of relating morally and with principle to other human beings.
I'm very fortunate that I'm in charge of the testing program. Diagnostics part.
Sterling Colgate remembers atomic testing differently. He was 40 miles away.
But when you're testing a device, we call it a device in order to remove ourselves. The warfare. It's just absolute. You drop the bomb on me. But you turn me up. You drop the bomb on me. Incredible rush. Here you are, 40 miles away from this atoll that's going to go. You see this vast expanding sphere of light getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and it just seems to envelop the whole blooming sky with this incredible fireball. And again, you keep reminding yourself you're 40 miles away from this thing. And if you're into explosions, as most of us were when we were kids, you know, and we've had to get away from it as we got older. Fortunately, I haven't, because I've since gone into astrophysics to keep it up and worry about supernova and quasars and universi. But here's this thing getting absolutely immense. It's covering the whole blooming sky. And you know it was a small point of explosion 40 miles away.
For more than 35 years, the United States has been conducting a bizarre series of atomic tests. The strangest test that isn't still a secret is the pig test, codenamed Priscilla. To determine the effects of an atomic blast on human skin, the Army bought 700 pigs and designed special uniforms for them. The pigs were tied in raised pens and subjected to the heat, radiation, and blast of an atomic bomb. pig test was written off as a failure. Unlike people, the pigs managed to survive with third-degree burns over 80% of their bodies. As a complement to the animal test, the Defense Department requested greater participation. You were my hope, baby, you were my smoke. You dropped the bomb, you dropped the bomb on me, baby, you dropped the bomb on me. But you turned me up, you dropped the bomb on me, baby.
Yes, if I may add a postscript about two matters. One is what I consider to be the alienated, if unconscious, hypocrisy of a statement such as the one I read before, whether it appears in the Reader's Digest, Scholastic magazine, Time magazine, the New York Times editorials, or wherever, or in the speeches of politicians. I have to say, one does not really present the unthinkable. And yet, the whole thrust of our culture is precisely in the opposite direction, but in the abstract. The kind of things that children are exposed to in comic books, in space movies, in TV serials, ad infinitum and ad nauseum, coerces the child into a view of catastrophe as being with us day and night, and at the same time, remote. It is there, but it doesn't touch one. It's something cast on a screen. And it's precisely that kind of an approach, again, witting or unwitting, which is expressed in this kind of condescending, patronizing, domesticated view of what nuclear war and its possibilities are. In this business of vicarious experience and of protecting children is no more than protecting the consciousness of all of us from the realities that we understand are there, but incapable of coping with them politically or psychologically or socially, attempt to evade by distancing, by trivialization. Now, how different this was, to elaborate on the other aspect of the footnote, to what I've already said, from the experiences of children that I've been able to see in among a very small, unknown people, now more or less the subject of ethnocide, that is to say, ethnocide, their culture has largely been wiped out. They still survive in a certain number, a very small group of people. When I was working among them in central Nigeria, perhaps 25 years ago, one of the things that struck me first was how alive the children were. They were not treated like infants. There was no baby talk. There was no unnecessary simplification. These kids were walking around playing drums at the age of 3 with skill. They were playing flutes at the age of 4 and 5. They were making flutes at the age of 6. They were learning to work in the gardens. They were learning to weave and so forth and so on. At the same time, during childbirth, there would be a kind of little semicircle of people that would be formed within the hut in which the woman was giving actual birth. She would have 1 or 2 or 3 midwives, all related to her. And in serried ranks, standing behind or sitting behind, would be other relatives and villagers who were close friends. And finally, in the outer circle, would be the children who would hear the screams, look at the blood, assimilate what was going on, but in an atmosphere that was loving and realistic, and because realistic, loving. The children did not suffer traumas from watching this kind of thing at all. They learned, they experienced, and they grew in the process. How different the isolation of children from the experience, and of men from the experience in our society, and of women from the experience through spinal injections and so on, until quite recently indeed. I could go on in this vein. Another example, right from the cradle, would be a small baby who will be carried in the large palm of the hand of an African woman who was not fed solid food but was at the breast on demand, but who needed water too. And water would be given to the child by the mother, cupping it in the palm of her hand, and they had no bottle with nipples, and she would kind of tilt the palm into the forced open mouth of the infant, who would invariably become absolutely hysterical with rage. The mother would smile. The infant would scream and scream and scream, and when the procedure was over, the infant would immediately calm down as if it had never happened. The point is that this was a difficult undertaking for both, but a necessary one, and done in a reciprocating atmosphere of love and care. The pain of the immediate experience melted into nothing. Thank you.
And I think that children should oppose of nuclear arms because we are the future, and what we feel matters a lot, because when we get older, we're going to be the ones who are going to be voting and deciding. So we should start to develop our opinions now, and if enough children fight for what they believe, I'm sure that somebody will listen to us. There are lots of groups like Future Generations and Children's Campaign that are for nuclear disarmament. And if you don't have one in your area, you should form one. Thank you.
Well, nuclear war and nuclear power doesn't do anything. And you can't just sit in bed and pray. You have to form a group to stop it, because the Earth will just blow up and there won't be any. Probably. And like Ronald Reagan, he usually just, I wrote him a letter and told him about it, and he just said that he was helping kids to pray and stuff. And I don't think that that's the thing you should do, because it doesn't work that way. You should form a group.
If they don't listen to us, if we don't say something, they aren't going to be able to hear us, so they won't listen to us. And it's the only way that we can possibly save our world is by fighting for it. And it's just important to do that. And if you think that your opinion doesn't matter, you're wrong, because it does. And each person matters, because one person can't save the world by themselves. It has to be a lot of people. Everybody has to help.
Well, like, the U.S. tries to tell other countries that it's safe, and they listen, being stupid, and they make the wrong decision. Like, people in Switzerland are now building fallout shelters, and they don't know what they're doing. And they have battle stuff hidden in highways and stuff.
Good night, and may the force be with you.
You took the bomb on me.